After the discussion of statistical approaches for classification and dimensionality reduction techniques, we will have the discussion on distribution-free classifiers. These classifiers will enable us to find the decision boundary directly, or the demarcation line, or the demarcation function that separates the class 1, class 2 samples, or several class samples. This discussion will be followed by the discussion on modeling neuron artificially or mathematically, and feed forward neural network networks. We also discuss on backpropagation in feed forward neural networks, and thorough discussion on backpropagation using the computational graphs approach will be outlined. We also spend some time on discussion on how the backpropagation happens in deep neural networks, and we will have a nice relation on which we can extend this backpropagation to any deeper network. We also discuss introduce convolutional neural networks, and we will have a application of these neural networks to digit recognition or image recognition problems. This discussion will be followed by support vector machine classifier, which is another supervised classification technique, wherein I will introduce kernel trick and discuss on the mathematical details involved in separable and non-separable support vector machine algorithms. So far, what we have discussed are the supervised classification methods. These methods need a priori labeling of data to start with. Based on the labeled data, they try to classify and label data. So there is a train and test split of the data in all these supervised classification methods. Whereas in some scenarios, you may not even get even few or even single labeled data. So when there is no labeled data and we have only data samples of different classes, and sometimes being known the number of classes, and sometimes even not being known about the number of classes, how do we group them, or how do we cluster them? That is the topic of unsupervised classification. So after the discussion on this supervised classification, we will bring to the discussion on the unsupervised classification. We will discuss on the unsupervised classification techniques. Therein, explicitly we discuss on an elegant technique referred to as expectation maximization, and one of the very well-known technique, that is k-means clustering algorithm. We also discuss on hierarchical clustering algorithms, where we need not specify the number of clusters a priori, and we also discuss some of the applications of clustering algorithms to image segmentation. Finally, we discuss our slightly different kind of learning approach, that is referred to as regression, wherein we try to identify an output variable rather than output class label. Say, for example, if we want to decide the cost of a land or cost of a building, so what do we do is we acquire some features, where the area, the place, location, value, and so on. And based on it, we would like to give a cost assessment. So this assessment can also be done through a learning framework referred to as regression. So that we will discuss, followed by the discussion on the supervised and unsupervised classification methods. Finally, based on the discussions we had by that time, I will discuss on the ensemble classifier, which is a combination of several classifiers for a practical problem like face detection. So this enables us, if we have several classification algorithms at our hand, how to make use of them efficiently. So to get started on the discussion, let us assume that I have the scenario that we started discussing in the previous class. That is, we would like to categorize the fishes into two classes. And these fishes may be from Solomon or Seabass fishes. And they are coming on a conveyor belt, and we have a camera on the top which takes the images, and we would like to automate this process of classification. So as discussed in the previous class, we start with the processing, the pre-processing, where we try to separate or segment the region of fish, and then we would like to align it in a single direction, because any measurements that we take has to be standardized. So once we align it and segment it from the rest of the fishes, what we do is we measure some attributes of it. So the attributes of this fish that we would like to distinguish between Seabass and Solomon can be the intensity values or the length values or width and etc. So now assume that we have measured some features, or these are referred to as features. So now this one of the features that we are discussing may be length and another may be lightness. So now given this scenario, now the question is, how do we make efficient use of this to say large data to do to make a classification model or to come up with a classification model? So now assume that we have say 1000 fishes, so maybe some 600 from one class and 400 from another class. Given this scenario, and we also we have the provision to measure their lengths or lightnesses. So how do we go about putting a decision boundary? The question is, say if I measure for thousands of samples or few hundreds of samples, so the intuitive way that we feel to put a decision boundary between class 1 samples and class 2 samples is through a threshold. So for example, if I say that all Seabass fishes are shorter and are longer and all Solomon fishes are shorter, then I may say that the length less than some 10 centimeters, I may say it is Solomon fish, length more than 10 centimeters may be Seabass fish. So that is one simple way of putting the decision boundary and to help us automated classification based on the measurements we made. But the thing is, so who will decide this threshold and how to decide this threshold? Because a single threshold is put to put all the samples of one class to one category, another samples class samples to another category. So this threshold becomes critical. So one example highlight how this threshold can be found is through making a histogram of the count of number of samples at given length. For example, if you see at 5, for example, at length of 5 units, so you can see that the number of Seabass fishes are only 5, whereas the number of Solomon fishes are roughly 17. So it means at a length of 5, you can see 5 Seabass fishes and 17 Solomon fishes. So this indicates that if the length is 5, then it is more likely that it belongs to Solomon fish rather than to Seabass fish. So now if we give this say count frequency for different length values, this is referred to as histogram of the length values. So now based on this histogram, we can put a decision boundary, and this decision boundary can be put in such a way that where the count or the frequency of one class is higher than another class, we can say that it is more probably that the testing fish, a fish at our test phase whose length falls to the category where the frequency is higher in training phase, will belongs to that class label. So so now if we put say based on this graph, if I say that the threshold is 15, so it means that all the fishes having the length values lesser than 15 can be categorized to Solomon, and all the fishes greater than 15 are categorized to Seabass. So this is very simple and intuitive way of putting a decision boundary if I have availability of only measuring length values. However, the question is this. So this, do you think that this is this accurate to separate the Seabass and Solomon fishes? By looking at the plot itself, you can say that this is not accurate, because even in the Solomon region, you can see reasonably good number of Seabass fishes falling. In the similar way, in Seabass region, you see good number of Solomon fishes falling. So it indicates that the just putting a threshold and classifying all the fishes lesser than some count to be some length to be Solomon and some higher than some length to be Seabass is not very good method. So now given the situation, do you suggest any better way of doing is the next question. So the answer may be, see, other than the length feature, see, all features are not equally important. Some features may be more important, some features may be less important. So we may look for another feature which will separate the Seabass and Solomon fishes better. Fine. And the use of histograms to identify the decision boundary is, however, is very good, because it takes not just takes one or two measurements, but it takes the measurements across thousands of fishes and summarizes them in a nice plot or in a single plot, and enables us to visualize which class has the higher frequency in what region. So this also is, see, the frequency at a given length can also be referred to as the class likelihood. And the class likelihood, now you can see that the Solomon fish in this region is higher. That means probability of length taking omega 1 class, if we consider Solomon fish as omega 1 class and sea bass fish as omega 2 class, probability that the Solomon fish takes omega 1 class is higher in the probability that the length lesser than 15 belongs to omega 1 class is higher. So that means probability of x, if x is the length, or probability of L given omega 1 is higher in the first half. Probability of length L given omega 2 is higher in the next half. So you can relate this class frequencies, these frequency of Solomon fishes and sea bass fishes at a particular length values also with respect to the likelihoods or the probabilities. So when we discuss on more on probabilities, basics of probabilities, and relating to the Bayesian classification, we will discuss this point in much more detail. Now you can see we figured out that the length is may not be a very good feature to separate out the sea bass and Solomon fishes. Thus, assume that we figured out another feature, that is lightness here, that enables us to classify or separate the sea bass and Solomon fishes better based on the count or the frequency plot that we have over these thousand samples at our hand. So now you can see that the lightness lesser than some 5 is 5 intensity, average intensity, or is better to be classified to Solomon, and the lightness greater than 5 may be classified to sea bass. Now you can see that the number of misclassified samples are very less. Misclassified samples in the sense that if we fix a threshold of 5, it means that all the light, wherever the average lightness is lesser than of an image, fish image that we consider, is lesser than 5 is put to Solomon in under some scale, after some scaling, and then threshold lightness having higher threshold than 5 is put to sea bass. And thus you can see that, see, only few fraction of sea bass fishes are classified to Solomon, and few fraction of Solomon fishes are classified to sea bass. Thus you can identify that one feature may be much better than the other feature in doing classifications. Okay, so now still you can see that this is not very accurate or 100% accurate in classifying sea bass and Solomon fishes. So now what do we do? So what is the next suggestion that we may give for enabling or designing better classification methods? So initially we used length, and we found that it is giving more misclassified samples, or there is a good mixing of sea bass and Solomon fishes with the same length. And we identified that the lightness is better feature for classifying them. However, it is not very accurate. So now given such scenario where you have each feature contributing to some extent, not to the great complete extent, do you suggest any better way of classification? So which feature to take, or which features to take? The answer would be to take multiple features. So now let us take the width and the lightness. So we measure for each of the fish, 1000 fishes we are getting on a conveyor belt, the length and the width. And we know that it is belongs to sea bass or Solomon. So what does this black dots indicate? Black dot indicate the Solomon fish here, which is having actually a lightness of 1 unit, and the length of width of say 14.5 units. Similarly, for each of the black dots here, this is the lightness value and this is the width value. Similarly, for each of the sea bass fishes, you can see, for example, this sea bass fish, if you notice, its length value is 10 units and lightness value is 10 units and the width value is 21 units. So it's like that. So each point here is a sample or a fish that image that we would like to put into one of the categories. Thus, if I ask a question, so how many number of samples do you have in this plot? So what is your answer? We will count the number of dots here and those many samples are there with us. And why this black dot and red dot are separately given different colors? Because this is supervised classification. As I mentioned before, supervised classification meaning we have actually the samples where the labels are given for each of the sample. So you know that this all belongs to Solomon and their measurements of width and lightness are as given by the corresponding dot location in XY plane, and similarly this for the sea bass fishes. Right, so now you can see that the decision boundary that we get here is much better and only few misclassified samples we notice when we consider two important features to do classification. And this plot can also be referred to as scatter plot. How the samples are being scattered in with respect to the feature values that we have measured or feature dimensions that we have measured. So now you can see that still there are good number of, at least few number of misclassified samples. Now, this is the decision boundary that separates class 1 samples and class 2 samples. Thus, any sample lesser than this decision boundary is put to Solomon fish, and any fish that is greater than this decision, that is other side of this decision boundary, put to sea bass. So that means that, say, if this line is something like W1 X1 plus W2 X2 or say A1 X1 plus A2 X2 plus B, where X1 X2 being the features and AB being the intercepts. So then you can see that this line, this is a straight line or a linear line that classifies the class 1 samples and class 2 samples. Okay. So now to improve further this classification accuracy, so what do you think? So still there are few misclassified samples. So is there a way to further improve this classification? So this is a general trend of thinking that is there in development of the classifiers. So especially this is the especially where you notice the either sample measurements or the statistics. This is the general trend that people try to look for, and this gives them an idea how the class better and better classification algorithms are being developed. So one way to improve this further is to, instead of having a linear line that separating class 1 and class 2 samples, what if we have a slightly curved line that can separate class 1 and class 2 samples? So now you can see that this is a quite curved line that is able to separate almost all class 1 samples and class 2 samples. So now you can see that all the class 1 samples are put to Solomon region, all class 2 samples are put to sea bass region. But however, do you think is this a best classification like decision boundary or a best classification method that gives this decision boundary, gives such a decision boundary? So the answer is not yes, because the reason is, see, if we want to represent this curve in say parametric form, we need large number of parameters, and this curve is plotted only looking at these samples at our hand, so which are like given for measurement and where you have labels with. Now assume that there is a test sample that falls here. So if you see globally without looking at this decision boundary, there are more of Solomon fish samples that come closer to this. So thus this question mark has to go to Solomon region rather than sea bass region. So however, if I put this very tailored and overfitted decision boundary, then I would put this into sea bass region. So this is usually referred to as overfitting, too much tweaking the decision boundary based on the training samples is not correct. Thus we need a generalized decision boundary at providing good classification accuracy. So here is one such optimal classification decision boundary. So you can see that this can be represented by second degree polynomial, this also gives reasonably good classification between sea bass and Solomon fishes. So as discussed before, so the evaluation of methods, how it happens is by looking at the class 1 and class 2 samples and trying to figure out what is the best way to separate them. And that decision boundary that separates class 1 and class 2 samples can be obtained either through probabilistic or statistical approaches or directly to algebraic approaches or the discriminant function based approaches that gives the decision boundary that well separates the class 1 and class 2 samples. So this is the general trend. However, there are several things involved in statistically modeling the class 1 sample distribution or how the class 1 samples are get scattered or distributed versus class 2 samples are get scattered or distributed, and how to demarcate them or to come up with a decision boundary. And then there are good methods or several methods that have evolved to what is the guiding rule to put the decision boundaries directly, or how to make it learn from the samples at our hand. So main references that I follow in this course are pattern classification by Duda, Hart and Stock. And this is a very standard and very elegant book on pattern classification and machine learning as well. So I will be discussing few topics like support vector machine more from pattern recognition and machine learning by Christopher Bishop. I will also refer Theodais and Kutumbais for some of the problems in pattern recognition. So the one main aspect of this course is to highlight some of the numerical problems for each of the technique I discuss. So in fact, there are very limited number of problems in pattern recognition machine learning reinforce or to clarify the basics. So that is where probably I will spend reasonably good time, and there are some good number of problems I formulated myself which will be solved and used for understanding different techniques. So wherever required, I will bring in some content from the digital image processing book by Gonzalez and Woods. And I very briefly refer at some particular point of time on deep learning book by Goodfellow. So there are several references, as you people know, that help us to understand these topics better. There are in terms of the video lectures by Andrew Ng and Professor Andrew Ng from Stanford and Professor Fifi Lee from Stanford Group. And also there are good data sets that will enable us to experiment and test and understand these techniques better. So you can see those references here. That's all on the outline of the course, and we get started on the topics from the next video lecture. Thank you.